Then it was really clear. He said, John, I want you to tell a story. I want you to tell a story that'll resonate with our audience, which is going to be mostly college students. I want it to be something meaningful and something they will remember for the rest of their life. Okay. So here's the story of the most important thing I've ever learned in my life, which I happened to learn while I was in college. I was born down in Miami, Florida, and to a wealthy family, and I got to go to prep school. I went to one of the top prep schools in the country, Gulliver Preparatory down there. Did well, graduated, and got accepted to a lot of different colleges, and I chose the University of Miami because it was close to my boat and my girlfriend. Not exactly the way you choose a college. So you can see I wasn't particularly serious about college when I started. So this is basically the way it went. I showed up the first semester, I got the syllabus, I went and bought the books. If it was sunny, I went fishing. If it was rainy, I went drinking. I had a great tan, I knew all the happy hours in town, but I had never stepped foot in class. I literally showed up from my midterm exams first year and said, hi, is this English 1101, the blue book, chapters 1 through 15? Cool, I read them last night. 1.6 GPA. problem though, I had a 1.6, all my friends had a 0.9, a 1.2, a 1.0. I had the highest GPA of all my friends. I was the academic stud of my peer group at a 1.6. Yeah. If I had a D, you know, F, D on a test, they all got Fs. They thought I was a god, you know. Man, you studied too hard. Let's go get another beer. You're just, you know. So, and see, one of the things I learned then is that's what's called positive reinforcement for negative behavior. I'm doing stuff that's terrible for me, and my friends are going, us too, let's go. You know, and you know, what would happen then is the worse it got, the more my friends loved it, because misery loves what? Company. And when someone is failing, what do they want everyone else to do? Fail too, so they can say, see, it wasn't my fault. You know, it was the professor, or it was the test, or is this, you know, like, they can't give a test at 8 in the morning. We just came in from drinking at 6. That's unfair, you know? So who would do that? So unfortunately, after my second semester at the University of Miami, I was expelled. But it gets better. The University of Miami has a thing called the Order of the Iron Arrow. It's the highest award they can give to an alumni. My father is Order of the Iron Arrow. Oh, no, it gets better, The year that I got kicked out, my father was on the board of directors of the law school. Oh, no, it gets better, There's a wing of the business, or the law school named after my dad. Yeah. Do you know how bad you gotta screw up to get kicked out of a college where there's a building named after your family? Whew, man. So I packed up my stuff, I grabbed my resume, my transcripts, I came up here to the University of Florida. I'll never forget it. I walked into the registrar's office, which used to be over in Tyrant Hall, and I handed the transcripts to the lady, and she went like this. We don't take people like you. And I went, but I really want to go to the University of Florida. She said, well, you may want to, but we don't want you. And I remember walking down the stairs, sitting on 13th Street in front of Tygart Hall, and crying, and thinking, I'm just on the verge of throwing my entire life away. I had dreams of owning companies and traveling around the world and, you know, being successful. And I've just had someone laugh at me and tell me, we don't want people like you. I decided right then and there that I would turn my life around, that I had got myself into that trouble and I was going to get myself out of it. So I committed myself to becoming an expert as much as I could about success. I became fanatical about reading, studying, learning everything I could about how to build a happy, joyful, balanced, successful life. I went over to Santa Fe Community College, which today is recognized as one of the most prestigious community colleges in the country. In 1983, when I was there, not quite. Basically, if you had a pulse, they had to let you in, and I got in on probation. and you know, and one of my professors, another person who changed my life, Roger Strickland, my economics professor, heard me one day talking in class that I really had to get good grades, and I was really serious, and I really wanted to buckle down and do better. And he said, if you really want to do better, I can teach you how. And I said, you can? He said, there's only three things it takes to be successful in college. I said, well, then, you know, tell me. He said, number one, read the books. He said, at least in college, all of the answers are in the books. If you just read and study the books they assign, 80 to 90% of the stuff you need to get an A is right there. So just read the books. That was an easy one. Number two, he said, ask for help. Ask the teachers, ask the TAs, ask the other students, find anybody you can and ask them to help you with class. Ask them to help you get better grades. Ask them to help you be successful. Which, by the way, might be the second most important thing I've ever learned. You know, a lot of people are afraid to ask for help. I mean, I was at the University of Miami. I figured out that's what made me fail. I didn't talk to my professors. I didn't talk to the other students. I didn't talk to the TAs. I asked no one for help. And what it got me was failure. When I got here and Roger talked to me, I realized that if you surround yourself with a big group of people and ask for help, everything becomes easier. It's one of the most important things you can take away. It's not, you know, a lot of people think it's weak or you're showing vulnerability or, you know, I'm not strong enough. I'm afraid to ask for help. The smartest people I've ever met in my life are the ones that are absolutely the finest at asking for help. So number two was ask for help. Then the third one is he said start study groups. You know, get a group of people there and work together and they'll be a good support group for you. So here's what I would do. At the beginning of every semester, I'd stand up in front of my classes and go, hi, I'm John. I'm going to have a study group for this class. I really want to do well. It'll be Tuesday and Thursday nights. My house, we can come study for 3 or 4 hours and we'll go out and get a beer together. You know, anybody that wants to come on over to be in the study group. Oh, as long as you have a 3.6 GPA or higher. Start out with about 20 of us, then 15, then 12, then 10. It got down to 6 of us. 6 of us that studied together, that had the same major. We went to class together. We took the same classes. College became incredibly easy. I had 5 friends helping me. You know, one of them would read a couple chapters, one to go visit the professor, one to go talk to the tutor. We'd get together and teach each other. I won't drag you through the whole story, but here's what happened. I ended up graduating from the University of Florida, number 3 in the entire United States in my major. I was hired by the Rockefellers while I was still in college. And then 3 years after graduating, I became CEO of an international Rockefeller Foundation at the age of 26, overseeing projects in 20 countries around the world. I've written a couple books, as you heard from Ben, top 100 thought leader. So things did turn out a little bit better. So I'd like to close this up by telling you now the single most important thing I've learned in my life. And this comes from a guy who reads 100 to 120 business books a year, and I have every year since 1989. Been through a couple of passports. You heard of the list of companies I work for. The single most important thing I've ever learned: you become what you focus on and like the people you spend time with. Whatever you fill your brain with, whatever you're thinking about, whatever you're reading, studying, learning, whatever you watch, whatever you put in your brain, and whoever you choose as your closest associates will directly determine what your life will look like a decade from now. And by the way, that works in college and it works for the rest of your life. What you think about, what you focus on, and who you spend time with is one of the most important things you can, because here's the tragedy. Most people don't think about it. They mindlessly fill their mind with mindlessness, and they just hang out with whoever happens to be around. So my lesson for all of you today is to be proactive about that. Think carefully about what am I filling my brain with, what am I really spending my time on, and who have I chosen to spend my time with. The other thing that I learned, which I told you a minute ago, is learn to ask for help. And then here's the last thing. At the end of the day, and I mean the long day of your life, when everyone's at your funeral and they're standing around, not one person's going to talk about how many boats you owned or how cool your plane was or how many houses you had or any of that stuff. I'm going to talk about one thing and one thing only: how much you loved them and how much they love you. So the key then is to live a life of love. Thank you very much.